Begin the current daf. Masechtas Ksubas daf Pei Zayin. Begin on the bottom line of Pei Vav Maveiz, which the Gemara begins the discussion regarding the halacha that we said on the previous Mishnah, regarding if a husband writes to his wife, he says, the neder and the shvuah I don't have on you. So we spoke about different specific wordings that he said regarding the ramifications. So the Gemara is going to open up the discussion saying, what oath are we talking about that a husband's telling his wife that I'm not going to make you take any oath or vows? Some of the discussion in today's daf are the halacha, the mission, like we just mentioned. If kasablah, he writes to a neder shvua, an oath and a vow, in li alecha, I have nothing on you, in your chlesh bia, that I cannot make you take that oath. What type of neder shvua, what type of oath is a wife obligated to a husband that he's making her not take that vow? Also, regarding if the wife must make a shvuas abetrapis, the oath of the caretaker, to the yersh and to dealings that were done before burial. So we know that when he's alive, he's exempting her. Afterwards, she's obligated because it's next to the same. What's if it's, let's say, between the death and the burial, would she have to swear for that too? Also, regarding the precise wording for his statement that absolves his wife from making a shvuah, as the Gemara is going to discuss, regarding what exactly are the words that he's saying, minechsai, nechsei ilayin, what exactly are the words that have ramifications? Then the Gemara discusses regarding a case in which a woman is required to make an oath to collect her ksuba, many different cases of the next Mishnah that she would have to take an oath. Some important terms and concepts in today's daf, there's a biblical halacha that if you agree to partial of the claim, you're biblically obligated, what's known as Maidu Mixes, to take an oath. And Einish Bun al Kavir Shibit Karkois, although there's certain situations you have to take an oath, but if it's regarding a denial of a lien of property when it comes to real estate, that is something that would not require someone to take an oath. So again, the Mishnah mentioned several cases of Kasav La Nedr Shvua Einli Alecha Ein Yochalash Biyah. So the Gemara is going to discuss there's two possible oaths from which he absolved her. Either Alapatropia Shonasis Bechaya Bala, as we mentioned in the previous Mishnah, there are cases where the husband appoints his wife to manage some of the fears during his lifetime and then she's obligated to take an oath. Is that the oath that we're saying he's telling her she doesn't have to swear? Or it's actually regarding what we're going to see in the next Mishnah. The next Mishnah on this daf, the opening case of a Pergemis Ksubasa. A wife admits to already having collected part of her Ksuba, she's chayvin the oath. So we have a machlekes in the Gemara as we begin the bottom line, Pevavim Abayz, Shabuah Maya Vidita. Which oath are we talking about that we're not specifying? We're just saying in the Mishnah, he writes to her Nedr Shabuah Einli Alecha Alayich, that the woman is obligated to her husband or to his Yerushim, that we're saying that if he's not going to exempt her, she'll have to take an oath. It's only when he lets her off the hook, then she doesn't have to take an oath. What oath are we talking about? So I'm going to read the Rav as a continued top of Pezayim and Av. It's about Chalekas. He says, it's Allah Petropia Shanas B'chayabalah. It's regarding the case of the halacha, the previous Mishnah, she became a caretaker in her husband's lifetime. So when he writes this to her, he's exempting her from the oath of being a caretaker. If let's say he makes her for his store, she runs the store on 57th Street. And he says, no, you don't have to take a neder shvuah. What is he coming to say when he's saying that? But let's say the halacha, the next Mishnah, which is called Pegemis Ksubasa. Next Mishnah on this daf tells us if a woman is paygim in her ksuba, which we'll see is when she admits to like having collected some of it, she can only collect the rest with an oath. Says Rehudim Rav, that shvuah, when he makes such a condition, he says that neder shvuah you don't have to make, it's not for that type of a shvuah. Because when he's letting her off the hook from an oath, it's regarding oaths that he's obligating her, which is, you're my caretaker, those things that I'm mandating on you. But an oath that she's causing to herself, when she's pegemis ksubasa, when she admits to partially having collected, she's causing that, that's not an oath that he's letting her off the hook. It's only the halacha of Abitrabash Nasabchai Bala, which he's the one that's causing it, then it's the oath that he's letting her off. But not if she's pegemis ksubasa, because she causes it, then she's still going to have to take that oath. That's one pshat. Reb Nachman Rabbi Rebbe, he disagrees. He says, no, ala pegemis ksubasa, that even if she's pegemis ksuba, she admits to having partially collected, she has a $10,000 ksuba, she says, yes, I already collected $5,000, but $5,000 I didn't. The next Mishnah is going to tell us she has to take an oath, that even for that oath, he's exempting her for sure from the shvuah of a trumpist, because he's exempting her from any shvuah. That is a machlekes regarding the halacha of the Mishnah, when he's letting her off the hook, is it only the oath that he's obligating, which is that of a trumpist, or even that of pegemis ksuba? So the Gemara continues and tells us, other Mordechai went, he said this following teaching, the question that we're going to say right now, Kamedu Ravashi. What was his question? So he says like this, Bishlam Amadam, I understand according to the one who says, Ala Pegemes Kesubasa, that if she is putting him a ksuba. That's the oath that he's letting off the hook from. The maska daita. I could understand that she's entertaining this idea when they're getting married. Maybe what's going to happen is, I'm going to need some money. I'm going to collect from my kesuba, which is my husband's estate has owes me $50,000. I'm going to want $10,000 for something. So she tells him when they get married, Kostovli, I want you to write for me, husband, that you're not going to make me take an oath when the situation is going to happen. So I can understand that you'll have this halach of our Mishnah of why would a husband write to her, neder shvur ein le'alayach? Because a wife is saying, look, I'm going to get married, you give me a huge ksuba, but I might need to collect some of it, and then I'm going to be chayv shvur. I don't want to take oaths. People don't want to take oaths. So he writes, don't worry, you don't have to. And as Rashi explains, once she's entertaining to exempt herself from those neder shvurs, so then she's saying, okay, just let me off the hook from all shvurs. So even if she becomes his CEO in whatever company it is, even that shvur, she's not going to have to take an oath, but it's not coming from there. Once she's saying, don't make me take an oath, because pagemis ksubas is something that a person would entertain.
And how do you deal with the fact that if she gets, she wants to rest of ksuba, she has to make it, she can't make a shvur.
Yeah, she won't have to take a shvur, exactly.
But she's out for the money.
What?
She's owed the money.
I'm saying, she will believe her without an oath, exactly, uh-huh. Because she's saying this when they're getting married. Then he's all excited, the whole bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, all excited, and she's like, no problem, just write for me that when I'm pegemes kesubas, I'm not going to take an oath. And then that's also going to be absolving her from apashapash nas b'chai bala. I understand. But says the Gemara al-Mandam, according to one who says, that this oath that we're talking about is only ala apashapash nas b'chai bala, is when she becomes a caretaker in the husband's lifetime. It's from that neder shvur that he's exempting her. Says the Gemara, ihi miha b'yada? You think she would have known this? The Mitzvah Lapetrapa, that when they're getting married, when he's 20 and she's 19, you think she knows that one day he's going to have this huge store department chain in 7 locations, and that she's going to be running one of the places? Dumbledore, that she's telling when they're getting married, oh, constantly delimish basli, write to me that you're not going to make me take the bills when I'm going to be running the big company. He's a schnook, he didn't even know that he's even going to, as Tais explains, Tais says, wait a minute, what type of question is this? Maybe according to the Amad, the Amma explained the halacha of the Mishnah is when she's already that Lapetrapa. And therefore, she's saying, you know, write me a star. They're married already 7 years, and now she's running this location. Write for me that you're not going to make it to Olu. So that says, Tesis, no, why would we push to explain the Mishnah that it's only now when she's Apatrapa to say the Mishnah is not talking about all situations, even if she's not yet Apatrapa, because Stam of the Mill says he writes to her when she's getting married. So if it's when they're getting married, so that's the question according to that Mandama. How does she know that one day he's going to have this huge company and she's going to be running one of the departments, that he'll have a shvuz of a trumpet, that she's telling him now, write for me, that you're not going to make me take an edder shvuz. So Amalei, so he answered to him, Rav Ashi answered to Rav Mordechai, he says, ho, atun ahomas nitinla. You, it's a little bit, these two dafim are a little bit more technical meaning, but these words are, you were teaching this halacha of Rabbi Yehuda, which was the one who says this halacha of apotropis b'chayibala on the reisha of the Mishnah, which the reisha of the Mishnah, which is what we just started off the Gemara explaining, wasn't saying which shvur we're talking about that is letting her off the hook, and you were saying that Rabbi Yehuda is the one who disagrees with Rav Nachman, and you were saying that Rabbi Yehuda is disagreeing with Rav Nachman, and therefore you had a question, meaning Rav Nachman had explained what's the halacha of a Mishnah that a neder shvur ein le'alayach. So he was saying, oh, it's on Hapagemis, it's on also Pagemis Ksubasa. And you were saying that Rabbi Yehuda Merav is the one who disputes him and says, no, it's only going up a Chabash Chanas B'chayibala, that's the case. So you had a difficulty. He says, wait a second, how does a woman entertain such a thing that she's going to have a Chabash 7 years later when they're married, that she's writing right for me, Nedr Shvoy in the Eliyah? So therefore you had a difficulty. He says, no, Anan, aha, we actually on the Sefer of the Mishnah Masnin Law. We taught Rabbi Yehuda's teaching that it's going on the Sefer, which actually is explicitly talking about the apotropos. And that's what Rabbi Yehuda is going on. The Mishnah said that if holcha mikeva ba'al le'saviyah, if she goes from the grave of her husband to her father's house, meaning she has nothing left by her husband's household, her husband died, so she's going now to live by her father. Or she even goes back to her in-laws. But she doesn't become a caretaker anymore. So the Mishnah said, "Eina Yerushim Meshviyin Naisa." So the inheritance cannot make her take an oath because the father had already exempted her from any oath b'chayav in his lifetime, and after he's dead, where the Yerushim take over, she never was caretaker. But says the Mishnah, "Nasa b'chayav if she comes a caretaker, then Yerushim Meshviyin Naisa Lasa Labe." Oh, then the inheritors make her take an oath regarding the future, because now it's their assets, not his. He can't exempt her from their assets. But they don't make her take an oath regarding the past. Now, the question was, what does that mean? In other words, what is called the past that you're not saying that it's the assets of the orphans and that his condition should not be effective? What's the past? You're saying the past, however, she doesn't have to take an oath. That's what the question was going on, and that's what Amar Vidim Rav was going on. He wasn't going on the Reisha and disagreeing with Rav Nachman regarding what's the halacha of Neder Shvu Ein Le'alayich. He was explaining this halacha, the Seifa. Amar Vidim Rav, he says, I'll tell you what the Avar is. Ala Petropesh Anasa B'chaya Hebal, regarding when she's Petropesh in the lifetime of her husband, that's where we're going to say that she doesn't have to take an oath. Aval Be'misa L'Kvuda, or between the death and the burial, regarding that, Mashbinallah. We actually make her take an oath. Why? Because the moment her husband died, the assets are belonging to the Yesemim, to the orphans. So the husband's conditions cannot be effective because it has nothing to do with his Nechasim. It's not his anymore. So Rav Nachman was not disagreeing with Rav Yehuda. Rav Nachman is explaining the Reisha. Rav Yehuda was explaining the Seifa. And therefore, you don't have a question. Your whole question was, who's entertaining to say when they're getting married that she's going to be 10 years later an apotropos? And you tell me that's the case of Neder Shvu'im Le'alayich? No. There was only one Rav Nachman. Rav Nachman was only, he explained the case of the Reisha that we're talking about Pegemis Kesubasa. If she's Pegemis Kesubasa, she knows that when she's getting married, that one day she's going to want to collect a Kesuba and that she's going to have to take an oath. She says, no problem. Neder Shvu'im Le'alayich. Rav Yehuda was explaining the case of the Seifa, which was saying that this woman who the husband wrote to her, Neder Shvu'im Ein Le'alayich, then he dies, then if she never is a caretaker ever again, she doesn't have to take an oath. If she is, she'll have to take regarding the future, but not the past. The question is, what's the past? That's what Rabbi Yehuda was explaining. The past is regarding whatever when the husband was alive. But between the time that he died and the burial, where she's probably still running the show, that she's not exempt from oath, because that's already next to Yisayim. The husband is not exempting her from his Yisayim's, from his Yerushim, it's from his own assets. And Rav Masnama, he disagrees with Yehuda on the Sefer, regarding which apotropos are we talking about regarding the past. Because regarding Pegemis, like we're saying, everyone agrees to Rav Nachman that she's going to be exempt, because that's a Shua that comes through his Nechasim. But regarding the Salach of the Sefer, he disagrees, he said, Afilah Be'misa L'Kvura. He says, even between the death and the burial, loibish bin law. We don't make her take an oath. Why not? What I mean, the husband only exempted her, like Rabbi Yehuda is saying, from his nechasim. The moment he dies, for those few hours that she's busy with, they're calling up all the different organizations and they get to get him buried and everything, this and that. So why would she not have to take an oath? Because the Amin Ardai, the Nardai say, this is related to a different halacha. What's called lecharga, is to pay up the head taxes of the orphans. Ulmazaine, to feed the woman and the children and the orphans. The kavuda, for the burial of a dead person or for the orphans. Mizavaninon, you could sell the assets of the orphans below acharasta without making any announcements. Meaning, usually there's halacha that when it comes to the nechasim of the Yisayim, you have to make announcements. You try to get the top dollar for the Yisayim's assets. So you make an announcement, you put out notices that we're going to be selling this, and therefore you get more coverage and people will pay top dollar. But in these situations, you need to get money very fast. You can't delay because of the precarious situation. So therefore, you'll sell without announcement. So what we're saying is that here also is going to be the same thing. That we're not going to make her take an oath regarding that sale when she's selling off something so she could get a plot for her husband to bury him, because it's not possible that she's not going to go ahead and be disgraceful regarding the value of the property and sell it at a lower price, because you can't be perfect when you're in a rush and high, you know, there's people we have to get buried. And therefore it would come out that she's gonna be lying and she's gonna be swearing to that effect. She's saying, yeah, I didn't misappropriate. You didn't sell with appropriate amounts. And therefore, that's why Ramasna says that even between the Misa and the Kavur, you don't make her take an oath because she's going to be swearing falsely. So that's the machlik is Rabbi Huda is going to Seifa, Rav Nachman is going to Reisha, and on the Seifa, that's where machlik is Rabbi Huda and Ramasna regarding what's considered Sha'ava. Is Sha'ava only when he was still alive, or Sha'ava even up until the burial, which the words of the Mishnah also seems to say like that, when she gets up from the Kavura and where she goes then, that's the future, but from between the death and the burial, that would not be included in the obligation for a note. Now, related to the halacha of the Mishnah, so Amar Rabba Amar Rebchia, he says, if let's say he writes to her the following words, Duloy nadar udaloy shvua, no oaths, no vows, so who in your flesh be, he cannot make a take an oath, Avol Yershemesh be nice, but his inheritance can make a take an oath. If he writes, Naki nadar, Naki shvua, cleansed from a vow, cleansed from an oath, Beinu ben Yershin, Emesh ben Nisa, then none of them, even his Yershin, cannot make a take an oath. Why? Because this is what he's telling her. Menakis mishavuasa. You're exempt, you're clean from any oaths, meaning from any halakha of Shua, it must be that his wording was indicating that it's not even going to be from his Yershin to be able to make a take an oath. That's one version of Rabbi Chiyah from Rabbi. Rabbi Yisrael of Rabbi Chiyah, he says a different version of Rabbi Chiyah. If you say Deloy Nadu, Deloy Shavua, no oaths, no vows, then who in Echel 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 Yeah, that's that. He agrees to the first version that he cannot make a take an oath. Abul Yerushim Ashbin is about his narratives can make a take an oath. Now, here he says the opposite extreme. By the case of Naki Nadu Naki Shvua, he actually says Benhu Ben Yerushim Mashbin Isa, the exact opposite of Rabbi's version. Rabbi's version was that none of them can make a take an oath. Here, this version is that both of them can make or take an oath. Because Hachakam Allah, he's learning that. What does it mean, Naki Nadu Naki Shvua? It means, Naki Nafshech Bishvuasa. Cleanse yourself with an oath. Meaning, if they're going to suspect you, then swear to them. So that's the machlik is regarding what are we saying Naki means, is that you're cleansed from it, you don't have to, or you're going to cleanse yourself by making a Nadu Naki Shvua. So it's not clear. That's the machlik is regarding what his wording is meaning. Continue on this theme, Sholach Reb Zaki Lebar Ukva. Reb Zaki sent to Bar Ukva, Bein de loy shvua, bein de naki shvua, whether the wording is no oaths, whether the word is you're going to be cleansed from an oath, bein de loy neder, bein de naki neder, whether you're going to, again, the same thing just regarding the word neder, not shvua. It depends. If he writes to her, bin nichsai, in my assets, then who in your chalash be, he cannot make a take an oath, abo yershmash bein assets, but the inheritors can make a take an oath. But if he says, bin nichsai ilen, from these assets, then it doesn't make a difference who the person is. Then it's going to be Ben Hu Ben Yerushim Imash Ben Nisa. Then whether him or inheritance cannot make a take an oath because it's not my assets, it's these assets. It doesn't make a difference who owns it if it's going to be him or the Yerushim. Now, Amar Rav Nachman Amar Shmuel Mishum Abishol Ben Ima Miriam. His version is Ben Deloy Shvua Ben Enoki Shvua Ben Deloy Nader Ben Enoki Nader Ben Menichsayu Ben Menichsayu. So he disagrees with the previous interpretation. It doesn't make a difference if you say Nichsay or Nichsay Ilen, my assets or these assets. Bein hu bein Yersha, whether him whether Yershim, ein mash bein Isa, no. Even from Nichsay, the Yershim cannot make or take an oath. That's what the really Dalach is. But if he says, oh, my assets, what could I do? That actually the Yershim will make or take an oath if he dies and she's collecting from them. Why? I thought you just told me that Dalach, the wording should be that they cannot make or take an oath. You're right, but Sharim Chum, because the Chum said the following halacha: Habali parim nixi. Someone's coming to collect from the assets of orphans. Yifrel b'shvu, you can only collect with no. That's a generic halacha, and therefore, though the wording is indicating that you don't have to, you're gonna have to take a shvua when it comes to the yersh. Now, Vegan Amrila, those that say this teaching of Abishol ben Ibn Miriam that it's a masnita, that it's a brisa, meaning it's not an amarok teaching like we just said that Shmuel says the name of Abishol. Rather, it's a brisa, and Shmuel on that brisa says halacha is like Abishol, so slightly different messiah. It's Abishol ben Miriam Amar. It's a brisa that he says ben delay shvua ben enaki shvua. Again, exactly what we just said. Whether he says it's not an oath, you can be cleansed from an oath, ben delay nader ben enaki nader ben menichsay ben menichsay lein. Whether from these my assets or these assets, ben hu ben yersha, whether him or his narratives, the halacha is imash ben nisa. Really, the wording is indicating no one can make or take an oath. What could I do? Because but the sages have someone's coming to live from the assets of the orphan. And on that brisam of Nachum of Mishmul, he says Halacha ki b'nei Miriam. So again, it's just a slightly different version. Was he just saying in the name of Abba Mir, or was he saying the brisam and saying Halacha is like that? But be that as it may, again, he wouldn't be able to make or take an oath. But the Yershin would, because you're collecting from the nechasim of the Yisrael. Now, continuing regarding the woman taking oaths, which was the theme of the previous Mishnah, and the previous Mishnah is, so here the Mishnah continues also with different halachas that a woman is required to swear in order to collect her ksuba. So we have five different cases that the Mishnah is speaking about. Says the Mishnah, Hapagemes ksubasa. If a woman is pagim, she makes a deficiency in her ksuba, which the Mishnah itself is going to explain what this case is. So the tifada, she cannot collect the rest, el bishvua, only with an oath. The Gemara is going to explain why would that require her to make an oath to collect the rest of her ksuba. Another case. Let's say one witness testifies that she already collected her ksuba. Not two, only one. So one is not enough for a dini mamanis, but like tipare la bishvua, she could only collect the rest with an oath. Again, the Gemara will explain what the reason for that is. Third case is minichsi yisaimim. Anytime someone's collecting, let's say, a ksuba from her husband's estate, from the yarshim, or case number four, minichasim b'shabadim, when she's collecting the ksuba from her husband's estate that was sold to others, or case number five, b'shaloi b'fanav, let's just collect the ksuba in her husband's absence, he's overseas. The halacha in all of these cases is leitipara, ele b'shvua, she could only collect with an oath. And the reason for that is because, let's say regarding the case of nechasim b'shabadim that was sold off to others, that if she would, if a person, let's say, would collect, let's say we'll call the husband the borrower. The borrower is the one who owes money to the lender. And the borrower would claim, swear to me that you didn't pay up yet. So the Gemara Shavuos says that we make him swear. Now, if he doesn't make a claim, we don't make a claim for him because ultimately the lender is holding a document, which in this case the woman's holding her ksuba, she's holding the document. But for lekuchais, for those who bought the properties of the borrower, what's called anantanin, we make a claim for him that maybe if you would be collecting from the borrower himself, he would have made a claim that swear to me that you didn't pay up, and then the lender would have to pay up. So therefore now also, we make a claim, what's called Pesach Picha La'alamu. We open up the mouth of the mute, where the buyer doesn't know, this the chasim is above him, the guy who bought, he doesn't really know. We make a claim for him, say, well, maybe you paid. And so too, when you're collecting the chasim of the Yisaimim, or if she's collecting when he's not there, it's all for the same reason, that the reason why we make her take an oath is because he might have made a claim saying you paid up. He would have had to make a shvua. So they don't know. I don't know. These guys are your son. These guys are they bought. So therefore, again, we make her take an oath in all these cases. Now the Mishnah goes by one explaining these cases of our Mishnah. So case number one was that Pagamis Ksubasa. If she makes a pagam in her ksuba, so she's gonna have to make an oath when she's collecting ksuba. Says the Mishnah Ketzah, what's the case talking about? So Isaac Ksubasa El Zuz. So if her ksuba was 1,000 zuz, he says to her, you already collected your ksuba. Vimesh says, no, I only collected 100 zuz. You owe me 900 zuz. That's pegemet ksubasa, because she's admitting to already part of the collection. L'tifre el b'shvua, she, and the Gemara will explain the reason why you have to take an oath. What check? So you collected already 100 out of the 1,000. Why would you have to swear the ground remaining 900? She could only collect with an oath. The other case was Eidech Me'ida Shipru. He said if one witness testifies as paid, she has to make an oath on the rest, meaning on the collecting of the ksuba. Says the Mishnah Ketza, what's the case? So as ksuba says, again, the same case, her ksuba is 1,000 zuz. Mamali says to her, the husband says, skibat the ksuba says, ready to collect the ksuba. The Yemesh, she says, skibat they didn't collect it yet. But Ve'edech Me'ida Shipru, one witness is testifying that it is paid on. So Le'tifra El Bishvua, again, she can only collect, she's required to make an oath to collect the ksuba itself. Case number three was Menachasim Mishabadim Ketza. What's the case of when you have, when it's sold off to other people, the husband's property, and she's coming to collect the ksuba now from those who bought for the property? So it's Machal Chazvachem. If the husband sold from his assets to others, now she says, you owe me 1,000, so it's like, Ein Li Chamnish. Says, yeah, but you had properties. So in the first one, she goes and collects from those who bought their properties from him. Here also, the Tifel Bishwish, she can only collect with an oath. Case number four, Menechsi Yisayim Ketza. What's the case of collecting from the assets of the orphans? Is Mace, if the husband died, but Nechsi Yisayim left over his properties to the orphans. If you're Nefres, when Yisayim is collecting from the orphans, but Tifel Bishwish, you can only collect with an oath. And what's case number five, the Shalibifon of Ketza? She's collecting when he's not there. It's Halakhlim and Yinsayim. The husband went overseas, been Nefres, Shalibifon, and she's divorced, let's just wants to collect the Ksuba from him when he's not there. In Nefres, El Bishwish, you can only collect with an oath. Now, as a contender with Bays,
is she married to him yet? Still?
Well,
is she married to him still?
Well, let's say she's divorced.
Yeah.
Oh, she divorced, so he left. It's not valid, just say.
Yeah. He's just overseas, yeah. So, Reb Shimon Eimer, and the Gemara's going to explain what this is going on. It's not clear what his words are going on. But he says like this. He says, Kol zman shehita ba'az ksubaso, as long as she's claiming her ksuba, hayirshim lesh bein naisa. Then the inheritors can make her take an oath. V'me'inita ba'az ksuba, but if she's not claiming her ksuba, in hayirshim lesh bein naisa, then the inheritors can make her take an oath. What exactly is it referring to? What's this this maxim that he's saying? What's this going on? So first the Gemara goes to the first case of the Mishnah. And the Gemara explains that Savar Rami Bachama Lemeimer, Rami Bachama thought to say that Shavua, this Shavua of Pagemis Ksubasa, that it's Deraisa. This halacha, which is Pagemis Ksubasa, is a biblical oath. Why? Because, I mean, first of all, the who cares if it's biblical or rabbinic? So Rashi says the nafkamina is that we're not going to be able to flip the oath, meaning that the claimant should take an oath. If let's say the defendant says, I don't want to swear, you could swear. And the person says, no problem, I'll swear. By biblical oath, you can't do that. Rabbinical oath, you could do that. So Rambam thought to say that when she's pegemis ksubasa, which is that if the ksuba was 1,000 zuz, and she admits to 100 having been paid, therefore the remaining 900 should have to take an oath, that's biblical. Why is it biblical? I'll tell you why. Because the katoin masayim, let's say a case where someone is claiming that he paid up that he paid up 200, because ma'idele b'meya, and the woman admits to 100 of that. I mean, let's say the husband, he's saying I paid up already, and she's like, no, only 100 was paid up. Havelo haydab mikta satayna. So this is what's called admitting to part of the claim, because he's saying I paid it all up, and he's saying no, only part of it. Now, we know that Allah in the Torah is whoever admits the part of the claim is Yishuv has to swear. So Rabbi Muhammad thought to say that this Shavua was a biblical oath. Amar Rabbi says, Shtei Tshuvas B'Davi, says, no, there's two problems with what you're saying. Chodah, first of all, the Chal Nishban Shavat Torah, whenever you have a biblical oath, is Nishban B'Lei Mishalma. What happens is that the one who is being claimed on has to take an oath. Like the Pasuk says, V'Lokach Bala B'Lei Yishalma. Meaning, whoever has to pay, he's the one that takes the oath. Now, this case is not like that. Vinish Baz Vinay Teles. She's swearing about partial of the claim that she's admitting to, and then she's collecting. So you can't tell me it's a biblical oath. Because Moedu Mikhtis is, I'm the defendant. Here, you're the collector, you're the plaintiff. So you can't tell me that this is a biblical oath. Void, a second point is, old documents, like a ksuba, are shibut karkois. There's a lien on property. Regarding biblical law, you don't take an oath regarding denial of a lien of property. As the Gemara tells in Shavuos Daf Mem Beis and Bav Metzidah Daf Nun Zayin Mem Beis, the Gemara there explains the source for this. But a ksuba is a shtar, which is shibud karkois. Biblically, you don't take an oath. So don't tell me, I have two reasons why it can't be a biblical oath. Zelim Rabbah, rather Rabbah says, it's medirabban. This oath is rabbinic. What's the reason for this rabbinic oath then? The reason is because the pada, in general, when someone goes and pays up, meaning the husband, he's dying. So he's careful. He checks. The mitzvah, the one that's being paid up, loy daik, is not so careful. So therefore, v'ram rabban shvua alav, therefore the rabbis impose an oath on her to swear that she didn't get paid. That she should be careful. Because generally the one who pays, no, I pay. The one who gets paid, not really paying attention so much. Now Rashi goes through a little bit of a cheshbon to explain that even without paygim, the halacha in the Gemara and Shavuos tells us that if, let's say, you tell to the one who has the document, swear to me that I didn't pay you, we make that person take an oath. Say, Rosa, he's claiming I paid you. So why do you need to have the case of pegemis ksubasa? And also regarding the case of the Eirachad who testifies that it was paid, even without an Eirachad, she would have to make an oath. So that says Rashi, the Gemara asks this in Sefer Shavuos, what's the difference between this and the case of Paigim Shtar? And the Gemara answers over there that when you have a case of Paigim, when she already collected 100, she admits to having collected 100, let's say out of the 1,000, and then the husband says, I paid you the rest, so then we make her take an oath, even if he doesn't claim, swear to me. It doesn't say swear to me. It just says, I paid you. But if you're not Poygim, even if he says I paid you, if he doesn't say explicitly swear to me, we tell him, go pay, because he's holding a document. So there is a fine difference between the case of Pagimus Ksubasa and regarding just between that and with the husband says, or whatever the defendant says, swear to me that I didn't pay you, that he has to say that, he has to make that claim. So here it's even that we're saying, even without saying Ishtabeli, we're going to make her take an oath because she's become a Ksubasa.
Wouldn't she have to surrender the document or put something in the document that was partially paid?
Right. When he's being begem is Ksubasa, but it could be that he paid her between him and her, and once you're admitting, so that's already gives us a reyesa, like you're saying. Generally, we're not going to suspect that. But we find that many times, that's when you drop a document and you find it, automatically start suspecting things. Anytime we have a reyesa, like a flag, we say, okay, let's take a second look at this, you know what I'm saying? We can't just let this pass by. So therefore, sometimes when you have something like pegemes, we're already thinking, wait a second, you got paid up, and you do you know if you got paid up the rest? You gotta take it home. Now, by the way, the following question. Pegemes ksubasa be'edim. Let's say this deficiency of her ksuba was with witnesses, meaning, like Rashi explains, that she says, I already received 100, and you're right, in front of witnesses I received it. Ma, what's the halacha? What's the question? Why is this different than the regular case in which she admits to being partially paid? Because in Isa the Pada, it would be true that the husband paid up the remaining 900, paid him up a parla. He would have paid up in front of witnesses, because you see that he's so careful and he brought witnesses to show, like you're saying, wouldn't we want to be careful, whatever? And he had his witnesses, Reuben Shem were there, that she was already paid up 100. So now that the remaining 900 is no witnesses, wouldn't that prove that she wouldn't have to take another? Because obviously, she was not paid up. Idimo, maybe, no. It's not because he was so precise and so dotting I's and T's that he had witnesses. Rather, it's from Yisra'amulay. It just happened to have been that the people were walking by then, they say, oh, Reuben Shem, and yeah, I'm giving my wife, here, $100 from the Ksuba. You see? But not because he was preparing witnesses and being all prepared, and therefore it's not a raya that the remaining 900 there's no witnesses that he didn't pay. So maybe she would have to take a shvur. That's the question. Someone says, such as being a raya from the following brisa. The brisa says, Kala nishban shabat Torah, all the biblical cases of taking an oath are nishban mulei mishalma, like we said before. It's swearing and not paying, not collecting. But there are a few exceptions. Ve'el nishban v'nei, in the following cases, you swear and you collect, because these are takans chachamim that you swear and you collect, which their reasonings are explained in Masechta Shavuos and Perek HaNeshbonim. What are the cases? So interesting cases. Hasacher, if someone is a worker, a hired laborer, well, he says, give me my wages. And the employer says, well, I already paid you. So therefore the guy who worked is going to swear that he wasn't paid and he's going to collect. Vanigzel, or let's say someone was seen going into someone else's house. And he says, give me my vessel that you took from my house. And he says, I didn't take it. A witness to see that he went out and he had something hidden under his jacket. They don't know what. So the defendant, meaning the nigzal, the victim, is going to swear, you took my golden becha, and you have to go ahead. And he swears to that effect, and then the gosman has to pay that. Or vanechbel. Let's say they saw someone going into someone else's house with his hand intact. He comes out injured, and he's all bloodied, and his hand is like cut off. So he says, you hurt me. He says, no, I didn't. So since we know that he was whole and he went in there and he comes out all bloody, and so again, the nechbel swears and he collects damages. Another case is v'shekneged chashal al shvuif. Let's say the defendant is suspected regarding oaths. So obviously you can't let him take an oath. That's a rabbinic takana that then the claimant gets to swear and collect. And mechemeni apokasei, which is you have a storekeeper on his ledger, where let's say he has written in his ledgers that this guy told me to give on credit, to give his workers, and I gave them, and they say, we didn't take. So both of them, actually, the storekeeper and the workers, could both swear and collect from the employer, because the workers are saying, we never went to Huckleberry's and got this apple pie. And the Huckleberry's saying, we gave them. We gave out 20 pies to your workers. So the employer's saying, whatever, which one? So both could swear and collect from the employer. And the last case, which is really the main case we're bringing in for, a poigim shtari. If someone is poigim again, which is this idea of making a deficiency in the document, which is, the document says you owe me $20 million. And I say, you're right, $5 million you paid me up already. Shaloi be'edim, that pagam, that saying 5 million was paid up already, was without witnesses. So that's why for the remaining 15 million, you got to take an oath. Because you were playing with the shtar already, you already admitted to part of it being paid up. But says the Gemara, ooh, shaloi be'edim in. Sounds like only when there's no witnesses, then you got to swear. But be'edim loy, but when there's witnesses, you don't have to swear because there's no pagam, because fakert, if 5 million you said there's witnesses, where's the witnesses of the remaining 15 million? Obviously, that you didn't pay me up, and I don't have to swear. Says the Gemara, no, it's not true. I can tell you the exact opposite. Loi mebayu kama. I didn't have to tell you that you have to swear. Loi mebayu beidim. I don't have to tell you that when there's witnesses that you have to swear. The father tzricheshav. Of course you have to swear on the rest. Because you're admitting to that 5 million that was already paid up. Of course you admit it. Because there's witnesses. And therefore what? You didn't do any hashavas aveda. It wasn't out of the goodwill of your heart that you admitted to the 5 million. You had no choice. Because of witnesses. Now that we know someone was paid up, maybe the rest was also paid up, so you got to swear that it wasn't. But when there's no witnesses, I would say that you have the halachic criterion of a meshav aveda. What does that mean? Because she has a regular shtar. If she wants to, she could have said, I didn't receive anything. And the shtar would have said, you're right. And she could have collected everything. And therefore, I would have thought, she could collect the remaining without an oath, because... Well, I don't have to admit anything. I could have gotten everything. This I admitted shouldn't make me lose out on the rest. Kamashma, that's a chiddush that even if there's no eidim, but don't be madaik to me and say, but if there is eidim, you don't have to swear. No, for sure that you have to swear because you're not a meshav of eidim. I would have thought that when there is no eidim, you're like a meshav of eidim, like out of my own goodwill, I admit it. And have to. Don't make me swear now on the rest because I said I admit it. If I didn't admit it, I wouldn't have been stuck in this situation. No, Kamashma, that even then, but it's not, doesn't answer the question. You both got another interesting question. Habegemis ksubasim. Let's say, again, Parkemis Kisubah means to say that there's a Kisubah for $10,000 and she admits to $1,000 of it being paid up already. But this time, she does a Pachas Mashavah Bruta. She does it like in small, tiny increments. Meaning, this $1,000 that she agrees to, that was already paid up, she makes a precise calculation. She goes through the ledger of the last 30 years they were married. She goes, on January 17th in 1987, you gave me $750 where I needed to go buy something. You didn't want to give it to me. You gave me that. And then in March of 2013, you gave me that. And she goes through mamash literally every down to the red cent. Then the question is, Ma, what's the halacha? Would she have to swear regarding the rest or not? What's the question? So the Gemara says, Mi'amin, do we say, Kim the code, Daiki Kulai? She's so precise. She has everything literally written down in her nice little calligraphy, her script that she wrote it, and you see like throughout the years. So kush to kamash, obviously she's saying the truth. And therefore she wouldn't have to swear regarding the rest. Or maybe no, she's being deceptive. Whatever, of course she's doing that because she wants it to look like that she has an exact cheshbon, but it's not the case at all. And really he paid her up the rest. Take a look, it's not clear if she would have to swear on the rest in that case or not. Another case is the Gmeibolu. Pechasas kesubas now. What's pechasas? So let's say her kesuba was 1,000 zuz written in a document. He says, I paid you up the whole thing. She says, you didn't pay me up anything, but I agree that the truth is that you stipulated that my kesuba is only going to be 100. So although it says 1,000, you didn't pay me up anything, but you don't owe me 1,000. Because really, although it says 1,000, we made up, I'm only going to get 100. So what's the question? So the Gemara says, Mirmin, do we say Hen Begemis? That's exactly the case of Begemis, which is that you're admitting that you're not owed all of it, so therefore you would have to swear in the rest? Oidema, maybe no. Begemis, what's the halacha Begemis? Is Moed Benictus, you're agreeing that you received some of it. So since you're, some of it you already received, maybe you received all of it. Halacha Moed Benictus, she's not admitting she received any of it. You never give me anything. But mitchila, we made up that it's not going to be 1,000, only 100. So that's the question. Is it similar to that case of Begemis, or is it different? Because ultimately, she didn't admit that she received any of it yet. Moshe says, Tashma, speaking of the following Braisa. Braisa says, Pechasas, the case of Pechasas that we're discussing, the Braisa says explicitly, it really answers the question, Tifrish Lebeshvu, she could collect without an oath. No, there's no Maidim mixes over here. She's not admitting to anything, and therefore she could collect it without an oath. Kate said, how so? What's the case? That's like Ksuba was 1,000 Zos. He says, his kabbalah kisubazach, I paid you up your whole ksuba. Bimele says, Mr. Kabbalah, you didn't pay me anything. But, Benya Lamana, really you only have to pay me 100. Because we really made up originally that although it says 1,000, you really only pay me 100. So therefore, says the Bryce and Nifra Shlebishuvah, she collected without an oath, that answered the question. But now the Gemara asks, wait a second. But my Gavya, Well, how is she collecting even that 100? Bahai Shtar with that document of that Ksuba? Hai Shtar Chas Balmahu. That document is a piece of earthenware, it's a piece of paper, because she's saying it's forgery. She's saying it's not a real document. She's saying it was never 1,000, it was only 100. So how is she collecting even that 100? So Rabba Bred Rabba, he says, by medicine, which he says, Amana Haisli Beini Le Beinai. Amana means there was a certain trust, meaning the document that was written and signed was appropriate. And it was received in front of witnesses that he owes me 1,000 zot. But we made up, he trusted me, I'm only going to collect 100 when we get separated. And that's what we made up. So that if I'm only coming to claim 100. But yes, the document is a true document. I'm collecting with this ksuba. But it's called pechases because she's admitting that really we only made up 100, but it's a true document. So she can collect the ksuba, but she'll only collect 100, but again she'll collect without a shvu, because it's not similar to the case of Pekibah, because she's not admitting that she was paid anything at all. Next case in the Mishnah was, Eidach Me'idah Shibru, that one witness testified that it was paid up, so he said she could collect only with the oath. So here also, just like in the case of Pegemis, Rabbi Chama thought to say that Shvu Deiraisa, this oath that when one witness says it was paid up, is biblical. Why? Because of Simba, the Pasuk in the bottom. Pasuk says, Le'yakim Eidach Be'ish, you cannot have a singular witness get up in a person, for any sin and any transgression, that you can't not make a person liable for Karban Chatas with one witness. You need to have two witnesses. Makes the Gemara Diyak, L'chalavin L'chalchatas, who they need to come. Yeah, for Karban Chatas, for sins, to prosecute someone, you need to have two witnesses. Avakam L'shvua, but a witness would obligate regarding an oath. And the master says, wherever you have two people making someone liable for monetary obligations, one person will obligate the oath on the money, where if there was two people, he would have had to pay. Now that there's one witness, then you have to at least take an oath. So that's the case of the Mishkan of Eidach, where the woman has to swear when Eidach says you were paid up and she wants to collect, she has to take an oath. Here also, the rabbi says, no state tribute or dumb. It says there's two problems with what you're trying to say. First of all, when you have a biblical oath, is nishbon b'loy mishalman. The defendant always takes the oath in biblical law. Here, the plaintiff is making the oath. It can't be biblical. Because here she's swearing and she's collecting ksuba. The second point is, we don't take an oath biblically when it's regarding denial of a lien on property. And a ksuba is a shtar, which is on shiba karkois, so that can't be a biblical oath. The Rebbe says it's midrabanan, it's rabbinic. And what is the reasoning of this oath then? If it's why the rabbi is introduced that oath of biblically is no oath, it's kedei lahafiz daiter shabal. It's to appease the husband. Meaning, because he has a witness. What do you have this guy? He said he saw. So to appease him, we make her take an oath. And that's rabbinic. But biblically, there's no obligation for her to take an oath. Thank you to anytime. Close.